Lawson was teaching in Castledare, and he was friendly with another art teacher who was teaching at Drama Hole just outside Derry, with whom I'd become friendly, mainly through a trick organised by his headmaster. And the three of us went to drink and talk about art in Bubbles McCafferty's bar on Castle Street. And it just took off from there. And I suppose most of the meetings that I had, or 50% of the meetings I had with Lawson after that, were in bars elsewhere, or clubs, or places where talk was more important than anything else. Even the drinking, I think. Lawson was probably the first critic of my work, because he did eventually become the BBC's and UTV's resident critic in many respects. And he did write for a number of publications. But I suppose that was his dry run. Not that time, but a little later, he moved to outside Lisburn. Anyway, we left the West and travelled East.
And so did he.
He managed, of course, to develop and create a lifestyle without what normal people would have required to produce the wherewithal. He established the lifestyle, and he followed the lifestyle. And he fascinated the two Americans who were staying with us when he came to dinner. They talked, and still talk.
They were two artists.
This absolutely wonderful raconteur, and a man who really, I suppose, would have been more at home in the big houses of Ireland in the 19th century. They're playing traditional music, reading poems, telling short stories. I mean, he had a great capacity for engagement.
But he told how his paintings were stolen when he brought them to Belfast, to the Arts Club, and they were stolen out of the boot of his car, and he was so amused by that. He thought it was a great honour, first of all.
It was also a wonderful publicity stunt, that the whole idea of stolen art gave it a value way beyond even Lawson's wildest expectations. I think he reached the front page of the Belfast Telegraph. They always had paintings underway, and they kind of evolved over time, that he left a painting, returned to it later, so that in many of the works there is this lyrical style which has been brought out from maybe 10 years beforehand, and he superimposes whatever new activity he's preoccupied with. He was also very romantic about his life, his art. His whole ethos was one of gentle romance rather than pragmatic determination.
Yes.
But everything he did undertake, he did it well. He was a good gallery director. He was good in the television and radio presentations that he did, whether he was talking about art or literature, or in fact, he was very well informed on a great number of fronts, and would, at the drop of a hat, talk about anything. And I suppose you get to be that way if you talk a lot and listen and read and engage in barroom conversations.
And have the time to reflect and walk on the shores and think. He was a good friend. I don't know anyone who spoke ill of Lawson.
No, and Lawson didn't, to my memory, speak ill of anyone else. I mean, he had a great affection for everyone. He taught at Friends School in Lisburn, where Colin Middleton taught for a long time. Mm-hmm. And I suppose that in itself was an attractive proposition for Lawson, who much admired Colin Middleton.
I don't think he'd have taken the job unless it had a track record like that. He wouldn't have taken a job in one ordinary school, you know. So he felt that was an honourable, he was an art teacher, but he was following in the footsteps of another artist. I'm talking to Jean about Lawson after he died. Jean said how much she loved him and how much other people loved him. And she said he was easy to love, but sometimes not easy to live with. I'm sure that's true. If you have someone who's a dreamer and following dreams, it doesn't always fit into the routine and mundane life of getting a job and plying along.
I suppose the consistent thread was his painting, and he continued unabated to paint right throughout the whole of his life. So I suppose there's 40 years of painting tucked away in various places.
Well, I hope as the years go on, Lawson's work will be more and more appreciated and people will be able to see it in a wider retrospective from beginning to end, because his family have a lot of his paintings still.
Mm.
We had a gallery in the centre of town in Alfred Street, which was at the back of the City Hall, and Lawson gave us paintings to sell then in those days. We never had a complete show at that time, and then the troubles came on, and I think Lawson was teaching here and teaching there and trying to earn a living, and we were trying to do the same, selling pictures in downtown Belfast with sort of the bombs dropping around us. And then by that stage he was doing the figures going across a sort of bomb site, or there was a grayness in the work too. The Bradbury Place picture, the church looking up Bradbury Place, figure crossing a bomb site, a girl maybe in a white coat, going across Great Victoria Street. He was wanting to have a literary content to his pictures. So you've got the technique and you've got the literary content. Then I think, one could say he was a figure painter, yet there was a series of bathers on the beach, figures on the beach. Probably people in Donegal might well know who those figures are, who those models are. But this would be Lawson meeting people and being impressed by people and saying, oh, I'll put her in a picture. But if I think back to some interiors and that would maybe be from his, if you, for want of a better word, his Belfast period, so you have a figure in a room. Now, then he's in Donegal, he's in a cottage, or when you come out through the door of the house, maybe a smaller house, you're in a landscape almost right away. The picture that I think his wife has now, it's the horizon and then this channel of light down the middle, and it's a cut in the bog and the water lying in the cut, and of course the light is reflecting in that. So I think he was living almost in the landscape. That would have been my sort of thought on it. Lawson got into learning from Middleton, Middleton's technique. Of all of the artists, Middleton was probably, I think one, apart from John Luke, was probably one of the greatest technique persons that I ever knew. And I think in some of those little gem-like pictures of Lawson's, with great colour and luminosity, you can see that. You can see, you can compare, make a comparison with Middleton. And Middleton certainly, I remember admiring our show at Malone Road many years ago and buying something from that. And it was Lawson Burch, but we saw it many years later in Dublin, sold as a Colin Middleton. So I don't know where that picture is today. That might be a controversial story.
He came to teach as a special needs teacher in a school near Lisburn, where I was teaching. He taught there for a short time. Then I discovered he had a studio on the Lisburn Road. At that time it was a newsagent and there was a barber's on the first floor. Lawson had the second floor up. I bought the two small paintings, Ardra, Moonlight, and another. And he said, I if I have a retrospective exhibition, that's the one that I'll be borrowing from you. And I said he'd be very welcome to borrow it. Lawson was a very generous character. I remember meeting him one day when he was wearing a nice blue tie. I had a suit exactly the same blue, so I said to Lawson, that would go very well with my suit. And he just whipped it off and said, there you are, Josie. So I did wear it.
My first memory of Lawson, I think, was in UTV Studios when I was a young PA working on programmes in the very early days. And Lawson would come in and show us paintings and some of his skills as well on television. And there was always a sort of a frisson of panic around Lawson when he came in. It was more excitement, I think, than panic. And he was such a lovable character. And the public just adored him. There was a great deal of feedback from his appearances. But I think he got a lot out of them as well, because he considered television yet another medium of getting his message across. He was exhibiting this painting, and I just fell in love with it, and I thought, I'm sure that's Ross Begg in some shape or form. And the red moon is a bit sort of like the end of the world, but it appealed to me a lot. And I bought it. I arranged to meet him in Nancy's once the exhibition was over. And we sat in the corner and I handed him over the money and he handed me over the painting. And we must have spent 2 or 3 hours just sitting, talking about the old days and what he was up to and this particular painting and the meaning behind it. He loved life, and yet, maybe in a way, there was a sort of dark side to his life. When I was talking to his wife Jean just recently, we were talking about the black ravens that seem to appear in his work, and then there are white birds which appear sometime. And I just wonder if that was two sides of his character. So I don't know what he was searching for. Maybe the perfect location, or the... I know he told me one day that he took his camera and he walked along the Strand, and he was often to be seen bending over a rock pool and taking photographs down into the rock pool to try to reproduce that, and being followed one day by an elderly man who thought this was very strange, didn't see the camera, just wondered what this man was doing on the Strand, and could he maybe help him? Was he in distress of some sort? But I think Lawson was always searching for perfection, perhaps, and maybe he didn't realise he achieved it so often. It was a shock whenever Lawson died, great shock to many people, and a bitter sadness. I still pass by his house and he's not there. So I go to Port New and go to his grave, and I paint little stones. I always leave a stone by his grave. And in fact, Jean knows whenever I'm in town, so to speak, because she'll know by the stone there. But that's my way of, you know, sort of saying, it was nice to know you. And I know he must be happy where he's buried, because he's got the view of the island and right out to sea, and the colours that he loved so much, and the countryside he loved so much. So he's sort of missing, and yet he's still around.
I was working in the Belfast Telegraph at the time, and I had a weekly television column which Lawson read. We didn't actually know Lawson at this point at all. But that, then 1976, and the troubles were very bad, and I think people felt a sense of frustration and the need to do something, and people did things in their various ways. And Lawson's notion, born out of that, was to do a painting, which it was a drawing which he called Monument to Ireland. And he gave it away, and it was on exhibition at another Royal Ulster Academy show. But he gave it away to me because he knew I was kind of, I had some sort of reputation, as it were, and knew that it would engender some publicity, and I was happy to oblige him. And, you know, we've never been able to afford one. The classic was when we went out to buy a carpet bedroom carpet and came back with...
That's right, via the Caldwell Gallery.
Via the Caldwell Gallery, and came back with a painting
Estuary Light.
Ross Beg and Donegal instead. So
We never got the carpet. That's right.
But we still have the painting.
That's right, yeah. I think we've been married too long.
Well, we're finishing each other's stories. Yes. Starting each other's stories is even worse.
Yeah. I wonder what Lawson would say about that now.
Yeah, quite a lot, probably. And, you know, there was nothing po-faced or austere or look at me, I'm a wonderful artist. Although he did dress like one, you know, the scarves and stuff for him. The affectations of that nature suited him.
Mm-hmm. And the hair.
Which was never kempt.
No, it was always, sort of had a mind of its own, that hair, didn't it? A character of its own. Standing in the churchyard of that lovely little church in Port New on that windy July day, do you remember waiting for Lawson to arrive? And Patrick Cowdy, who loved Lawson dearly and sadly died last year. But I remember Patrick saying, "Trust Birch is the only person you know who'd be late for his own funeral."
And he was indeed.
Well, Lawson was really, he was a connection between childhood and adulthood, really, because Lawson used to come around here in the, when I would have been an upper, like in the 60s. We just struck up a relationship, but he was a very affable sort of a person, and he could talk to anybody, be it, he could talk to the Queen, he could talk to the beggar, like, you know, he really, and he just had a very easygoing nature. My mother used to always give out to him because, I mean, Lawson could take a drink, but drink for drink, it's no great boast, but I'd put him under the table. So we'd go off, and not deliberately off on a tear, like, I mean, it was kind of when drink driving wasn't just as frowned upon as it is now. You know, we'd go off to do a message, you know, and of course, we wouldn't come back till, well, we'd usually be back before bedtime, like, you know, but my mother, she was more active at the time, but she used to give out stink to him. And, but it was me to blame more than Lawson. And we had a few funny days. We went away with the dog one day and to, pretty well up this until Agnes here. There was an old man called Pat living in there in the schoolhouse. And I can't even remember now where we were selling the dog or buying the dog. But it ended up better. It was a long day, and he had a great twinkle in his eye, and whereas he could recount about the past. I mean, he could tell stories about the past, but he never lived in the past. And he didn't so much look to the future. I mean, he was a guy for the present, like, you know, it just, today was today, and let's get on with today, you know. There was an American lady who was his agent, his last agent in Belfast. And it was great. Lawson was, this is great. We sold another one, like, you know. And then a couple of weeks later, cut. We sold another one. But then after a period of a few months, she was looking for more pictures and wanted more. And then it was, oh God, this woman's putting me under. You know, he enjoyed doing the painting and selling it, but having to do it and sell it was, you know, it wasn't in his makeup. When I started going out with Anne's my wife of 30 odd years, but Anne's from Port New, and on a Sunday, most Sundays anyway, I used to make my way down to Port New. But I asked Lawson to do a painting off Port New for me. But if you look up from the beach, the church is on the skyline, and at the time Anne had she had a very bright yellow coat. You know, you could see this yellow dot just passing the church, and I knew then it was set for the evening or the afternoon or whatever. He just always had a bit of fun with him, you know, so he was a huge miss.
I was always very interested in his paintings. I think I was probably influenced a fair bit by the way he used texture and the way he painted landscapes, which I was interested in. I think we're similar in sort of a, you know, I just like the way he used texture, use accidents to describe things, which I like doing as well. And really everything that occurs in nature is an accident in its own sort of a way. I remember he lived in Letcher McGuard at the time, and his dream was to be sort of self-sufficient and leave the rat race. He gave up teaching, and he decided he was going to cut turf. We became great friends, suppose, after that. And he moved to Glenties. Actually, I got him a house out the road, because this self-sufficiency didn't work out so well. Lawson, he wasn't good at the cutting of the turf or the digging the potatoes, so he decided to move into a more civilised area. We came to Glenties. He used to ring me up every now and then, says, Johnny. I says, yes, Lawson. Do you want to come out to play? Because that was down for a few pints. Got me in a lot of trouble a lot of times, but he used to say, actually, he says, you know, us artists, you know, we're just like children. You know, what does a child do? They draw pictures and they act out roles and they. We're just children that haven't grown up. The first time he became ill, it was when he was in Glenties, and he actually rang for me to say that he wasn't in good form. I got a doctor out. The doctor told me to drive him straight to Letterkenny, and took him there. He was told at that stage that he would need to change his lifestyle. He was told to go on a diet. He was told to give up the drink. He was told to give up the smoking. Of course, Lawson didn't ignore it. Just didn't do any of these things. He kept on drinking and smoking and entertaining everybody else. And I think he added a sparkle into everybody's lives that met him. He was great character. Certainly added a bit of spice to my life. We had great fun together. I think he had dreams of doing all these things, of being completely self-sufficient, not depending on anyone else, so being able to paint when he wanted to. No pressure of galleries wanting his work. I think he just wanted to paint in his own pace. He never tried to be too avant-garde. I think he always wanted just to, I think landscape was what he wanted to paint. But he wanted to paint it a wee bit different from the usual landscape painters. And I think he was very successful in combining the landscape with the surrealist. I feel an emptiness there, especially when you go over to Arthur Allen. When the Nancy's is, and he's not there, you're always waiting for him to come in the door and say something very silly, very funny. And I miss him a lot. I think anyone that ever came across Lawson will miss him. He brightened a lot of people's lives, and I think we're just that wee bit more. It's a duller life without him.
I first met Lawson Burch and Anna McCarrig, the retreat in County Monaghan for writers and artists set up by the late Sir Tyrone Guthrie. And both of us were rather surprised at the time to discover that most of the residents then were rather staid and straight-laced and abstemious, while Lawson and myself enjoyed the convivialities of the local tavern. Then Lawson came to live in County Donegal in the area he liked best, the Ardra Glenties area, and I got to know him really well. And very frequently we'd go and have drinks and a chat in that wonderful pub in Ardra, Nancy's. We discussed all sorts of things, poetry, philosophy, and of course there would be some gossip. But, and of course, Lawson would tell these marvellous stories. I remember often discussing with Lawson Bernard Berenson, for example, Roger Fry, Clive Bell, aesthetics, and Clive Bell's theory about significant form, in which he laid down that a certain combination of colour and line could produce aesthetic emotion. We got a lot of mileage out of things like that. And then Lawson, of course, was very much interested in the work of Rudolf Steiner, and he was, in fact, an authority on his work. We discussed Kierkegaard and Kierkegaard's theory that truth is subjectivity. And we discussed numerous things like that, T.S. Eliot, and frequently the work of Louis MacNeice. He was an admirer of MacNeice's poetry. Lawson was a very versatile man. He was short story writer, as well as being a painter, of course, primarily a painter, and he wrote poetry. He showed some of his poetry to me. He was a lover of good food, good drink, and he was a first-class cook. Lawson was very much on the side of life. He loved life. He loved life passionately. He loved the landscape. And he loved the world in general. He was a family man, a firm Christian. We had long arguments about Christianity and about the existence or non-existence of God. But he was a very, very, very much on the side of life. But he did suffer from occasional bouts of depression. He placed no value on money and was generous to a fault. When I think of Lawson, and I think of him very frequently. I think of him as I think of him as a plump, middle-aged cherub, materializing in the doorway of Nancy's, wearing a silk cravat. He was always something of a dandy, with a mop of tousled curly hair and an impish smile on his lips. That is, cherubs can have impish smiles. But he always radiated goodwill to everyone he encountered. He was a very good man and a fine painter. And I was privileged to know him and to love him.
Early memories of Lawson. You know, he was, for me, he was always around. And nothing really sticks out until I come to things like being off on holiday in our little summer house we used to take up near Leitrim. Lawson was there. He was keen to paint, and so but also keen to spend time with us. And well, we used to play cricket and so on. Very occasionally, one of the two of us, or three of us, if Dermot was there, would step out of line. And Lawson's idea of punishment was to be sent down to a tree which overhung a little river nearby, known as the punishment tree. And we get sent down there, and the punishment was to stay there for an hour. And whenever you look back on it, really wasn't that bad at all, because you were beside a little river. There were brown trout in the river that you could see if the sun was right. And you'd watch the brown trout swimming up and down the river for a while, and then there might be a kingfisher as well, would flip by occasionally. And then you get bored and break a twig off the tree and chuck it into the river and see how long it took to get to the other side and so on. So after the hour was up, you really came back in a much better frame of mind.
Lawson used to love cars, and Lawson had a big white Jag and had red leather upholstery that he was always very proud of. And on your birthday, we used to have a birthday day out, and in it was maybe going to the zoo or whatever, and I remember going up the M1 motorway into Belfast in this Jag with Lawson at 100 miles an hour, which was great, actually, and I think he enjoyed it probably. It was his birthday as well, really.
But the alternative that was offered to me was, you can either have a party with all your friends around for your birthday, or we can go out for the day. Now, as a parent now, it's much easier taking one child out for the day than it is to organise a party and so on. I've tried the same with my own kids occasionally, but they always go for the party for some reasons.
No Jag.
That's probably it, yes. I don't know a Jag. Lawson used to come home cock-a-hoop because he'd sold a painting somewhere, or perhaps after a good exhibition opening or something, and it would be fish and chips on the way home and so on, so he wouldn't have to cook that night, or Jean wouldn't have to cook. And the old phrase that springs to mind is, when Daddy eats ice cream, we all eat ice cream.
The other thing which I often think about is the fact that Lawson never asked us to call him Daddy or to call Jean Mummy. It was always Lawson and Jean. And I think that he always looked at people, kids as much as adults really, that they were individual little people by themselves, and even though he was our father, he preferred, I think, to people to regard him on an individual basis, and he them, really. So it was always Lawson and Jean as opposed to Mummy and Daddy, really.
If anybody listening to this, you know, has had the luxury of having a meal with Lawson, they'll always remember the dried peas that they found in the middle of his risottos and so on, because it was a real theme in his cooking. He certainly enjoyed the dried peas and lentils and so on. But he was very, very good at making up his own recipes. And it was a matter really of going to
the fridge or the larder and having a look to see what was there and cooking it all up. And invariably he would come out with a very acceptable meal. But the dried peas was the theme running right through a lot of his cooking.
The other thing, actually, I think when we were kids, I suppose everybody had somebody that looked up to or was a hero or whatever. And I think Lawson, actually, on reflection, probably always was my hero in many respects, because he did follow his own path very much. And the decision to stop teaching when he had a young family and a certain financial instability, shall we say, was a big decision to make. And I often thought that it was admirable. And as I grew older, and Lawson's not around anymore, as you get older, I suppose I'm at almost the same sort of age as when he did that, when he stopped teaching, you really begin to get a sense of perspective of how big a decision that actually is, and your appreciation for his commitment really just grows each time, I think, when you think about that. And it led to good times, it led to difficult times, but they were times of his own making. And I always remember he used to say, people used to visit him in Donegal, and he was always, he never made lots of money from his art, but he always, as he always said, something always comes along, and it always did for him. But people would say, "Hi, Lawson, you know, it's must be difficult for you here." And he said, "Well, I've managed to buy my time, and I can get up in the morning and think, well, I'll go to work, or well, I'll go for a walk on the beach. That for anybody to have that sort of, I suppose, control over their life to a large extent, or that freedom to follow their dream, I think is a fantastic thing. And I think it's something that a lot of other people looking at Lawson were very envious of, and he sort of showed them that it was possible, and I still think that that's if more people could do that, then, you know, they might find the sort of joy that he found and other people found in him really as well. But that certainly and he also used to say, people who paint for therapeutic reasons aren't doing it properly. So it wasn't an easy lifestyle. People think you can sit and paint and then go and have a pint and things are sort of fairly free and easy, but I know that he didn't. He always appeared that way, but underneath, I think he struggled his rest, as much as we all do in our various sort of occupations, but he was doing it in his way, really, which I always admire.
Simon talks about the idea of lifestyle and so on. I don't think I've inherited any of that from Lawson. I do enjoy the outdoors and so on, but if I can have hot water, I like to have hot water and so on. Whereas Lawson would be quite happy just to have carried on with what he had and painted away. And I admire him for literally getting up and sometimes in Donegal camping out inside the house and getting on and painting. It certainly for me wouldn't have been the most conducive atmosphere to good painting and so on, but it's what he seemed to enjoy.
You think?
Well, I don't know.
One thing which I learnt a lot from, actually, just after his death, was that we had a wake for him at his house, and which lasted 2 or 3 days, and the number of people that came to the wake and helped us out and sat and told stories and was unbelievable. And it really, for me, showed the sort of strength of his friends that he had in Donegal. Other people came from further away as well, but certainly the people close to him, like Charles and that, were fantastic support, and it really showed me that that he had great friends there, and what better thing can a man have, really, than to have true friends? Everywhere I go, you say, the people say, "Are you?" And I say, "Yes, I'm son of Lawson." And they go, "Oh, yes, okay." And a story starts. And that's it still sort of surrounds you with him, I suppose, and people's affection for him, and it's still, that's very comforting, and that's it's a great thing to have that, to have people talk to you about your father with a smile on their face, really.
When I first met Lawson, I was introduced to him. I was training as a student nurse in City Hospital in Belfast, and he was a student at Stranmillis. We met and, we went out together for a while, and then we sort of, it petered out, and he went off to London to work for the summer. And after he came back from, he actually wrote to me from London and said, well, I would like to meet you again whenever I come back, which is what happened. And I was finishing my student nursing, and he was finishing with Stranmillis, and we got married a couple of years later, and we lived for a few months in a flat on the Ravenhill Road in Belfast. And I think probably we both had itchy feet, and after a few months we thought it would be nice to live by the seaside. So we went to Grimsport, and we had a flat there in Grimsport, which was very nice, overlooking the sea, the first floor. And I can remember well, he had a studio, the flat was on the first floor, and there were two rooms upstairs, and he took those over as a studio. And there was a fireplace in our bedroom, and every morning when I woke up, there would be a painting, wet, but sitting on the fireplace. And I woke up, opened my eyes, and here was this painting, I can't really remember what they looked like, but, you know, he was really at that stage working very hard. Then Dermot did have to have hospital treatment, so we came back to live near Belfast, and he got a job teaching in Friends School, the Quaker School, Grammar School in Lisburn, and he taught there right until he decided to give up teaching, which was, I think, about 1978. He came home one day and said, I don't want to be a teacher anymore. He had threatened to do it several times, you know, but we couldn't quite manage it always. And then we decided, yes, that we would try and support him. I had gone back to part-time nursing at that stage. Dermot had gone to live in Glen Craig, and the boys were at grammar school. So we lived there for quite a long time. And then we moved out to a country house, and that's where we lived until Dermot, till Lawson went to live in Donegal at the end of 1988. And at that stage, I think we both were on different paths. I had what I felt I wanted to do with my life, and he wanted to be a painter and to be full time. So I went to live in the community for a year, and he went to live in Donegal. We were always in very close contact. I went up, he came down, we telephoned, we talked. It was, it had its moments, but it was an amiable way for both of us, I think. I'm sure he was lonely at times, I certainly was. But we had the cottage, and we would have gone up a lot to the cottage. And I can remember when he did his first television work in 1969, he went off to do, it was an art, something to do with art anyhow, and he came home, he had recorded it at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and he came home, of course, to watch it with the family, you know. And I think he couldn't believe it in a way, you know, and he kept saying, oh, but didn't I look awful, look at me, wasn't I, you know, this sort of thing. But then again, he did quite a few of those, and he did a thing called Portrait of the Artist, interviewing various artists. But then the troubles really took over, and all the programmes were news programmes, you know, it didn't follow on any longer, you know. Life was never dull. It was interesting one way or the other, you know. And Dermot and I always went to Donegal. Dermot had his holidays, and we went for Lawson's birthday. And for a variety of reasons, that the year that he died, we couldn't go in July, and we decided that we would go. I said, well, look, Dermot, there's a lot of things happening, and I said, we'll go in June. And he came here on the 5th of June for open day, and the whole family were here, and he went off to Donegal that evening, and we followed on the Monday, and we had a lot of outings, and we had a meal in Burtonport on the Thursday. And he said, because he lived in his house and I lived in the cottage, but he came up and we went down a lot, and he said, we'll go out on Saturday, where would you like to go? And I said, I'd like to go to Letterkenny. So he said, right, I'll meet you at, where was it, Fintown, I think it was, so neither of us would have to do the huge drive, and you can leave your car there and we'll all go on together. And that morning I got a phone call to say to come down. He was ill, and well, you probably know the rest. He asked me to take him to hospital, and I said, I'll call an ambulance. No, I don't want an ambulance. And I said, let me call the doctor. No, I don't want a doctor, I want you to take me. And I didn't really know where the hospital in Letterkenny was, but we set off, but we just got the length of Glenties when I said, Lawson, we have to do something. And I said, I'm stopping at Johnny Boyle's house, and we stopped, and I went in, and we called a doctor from there, but he died there within about 20 minutes, really. It was a very big shock for an awful lot of people. I wasn't so shocked, but I was shocked, of course, but in a way, I could see it coming, you know. But he didn't sort of say to people that he was ill. I don't know that even the boys knew that he was ill. And also, you know, someone said to me afterwards that it was a very tidy death, was how they described it, because had he had gone to hospital and had been lying in hospital, because he used to say, no, I don't ever want to lie in hospital and people bringing me grapes and eating them themselves, you know, things like this. So that really for him, it was the way I know he wanted to go. Is that all right? Good.
Well, I don't know. My father is being very old now. He's in the spirit. And we have every other study tonight. It's called Reading of the Dead. Every study.
And we remember him then, don't we?
Yeah. That's right.
We have something in the community on a Saturday evening, just for, there's just a few people go to it, maybe 8 or 10 of us, and it's called the Reading for the Dead. And Dermot and I go there every Saturday, just for 10 minutes. And it's just nice.
Thank you. I did a series of paintings called Childhood Memories, which were purely about what I remember from my childhood. I grew up in the country, you see, and I remember byres and hay fields and so on. And then I thought to myself, what was my childhood really like? Excuse me. And it was about, I grew up in a fairly strict background, you know. And being a country child, of course, I was young but innocent and a wee bit timid. And the painting came about, you know, a little child looking out on the world. I like to look at things very closely, you see. But at the same time, I was living within a very structured society, I suppose, and hence the painting. I suppose as you get older, said he, as soon as you get older, you tend to think more about what was, you know, what went on in the past, you know. So what I did was to think in terms of those things that I could remember, which will never return again. I mean, you're never going to see a buyer. You see milking parlours now, perhaps, but it's a sort of a personal diary, if you like. My third son, Dermot, is a Down syndrome child, and he was at Glen Craig, and one day he and his class came to visit me, and Dermot presented me with a bunch of flowers, which I thought was very nice. And we all sat around and talked about painting, and they did some painting for me in the studio, and it was a very pleasant afternoon. And when they were all gone, I looked at the flowers, and I thought, that might make a nice little painting with a certain reference to Dermot. So Dermot's flowers, one or two, came into existence. Yes, people say that perhaps we live too close to the troubles here to look at them. But I think at the same time that writers and artists must hold up a mirror sometimes to society and say, look, this is what it's about, this is how you look. There are two that I have given a good title to, I think, if you don't mind my saying so, Forward to the Glorious Past. Because I think when you look at what people are saying, they're trying to go backwards. They're trying to go back to what life was like in Ulster a long time ago. They forget that in the 20 years that we've had troubles, we have moved on so much. I mean, I can see the resolution of the troubles in a sense in a United States of Europe, because now we owe money to the International Monetary Fund, or the multinationals decide what we buy and so on. We can't go back, we must go forward. And the two paintings are really, you know, an indication that I'm very much against violence, and that I think that the situation will be resolved eventually, but in a sort of global context rather than a purely local context. That sounds very political, doesn't it? I'm not a politician.